In Spare, Prince Harry claims that their father implored them after Philip's funeral, "Please, boys, don't make my final years a misery." While that may be the case, there's been some frivolous actions on Harry's part that makes people question, does he want to become king? Being the Spare is our first segment, and it's always been a touchy subject for Prince Harry, one he's very hot and cold about in his novel, and leading to musings that maybe there's a little anger under his seemingly calm, aloof demeanor towards the succession pattern. While William, the heir, was destined from birth to be king, Harry, who is now fifth in line to the throne behind his brother and William's three children, has often appeared to struggle with the more ambiguous role of Spare, a term derived from the historical statement of an heir and a spare, the son that takes the crown and the backup in case he dies. I mean, it's fair to let something like that bother you if, as Harry stated, he'd been called a spare mean-spiritedly since the day of birth by multiple family members. He quite literally chose the word spare as the title of his 2023 memoir, which recounted a lifetime of sibling grievances, from William getting the bigger bedroom at Balmoral Castle to a ferocious argument in which Harry claims William ripped his necklace and knocked him down onto a dog hole. In a few key passages within his memoir, Spare, Prince Harry gives his thoughts on his position in the line of succession. He writes how Charles always called him the Spare, and how, quote, being a Windsor meant working out which truths were timeless and then banishing them from your mind. It meant absorbing the basic parameters of one's identity, knowing by instinct who you were, which was forever a byproduct of who you weren't. I wasn't Granny, I wasn't Pa, I wasn't Willie. I was third in line behind them. In a separate section of the memoir, Harry recounts how he was asked his feelings on being moved down the line of succession after the births of his nephew, Prince George, and niece, Princess Charlotte. I was delighted for Willie and Kate, and I was indifferent to my place in the order of succession, he said of George's birth in 2013. In 2015, when Charlotte was born, Harry wrote, I was an uncle again, and I was very happy about it. But predictably, during one interview that day or the next, a journalist questioned me about it as though I'd received a terminal diagnosis. Speaking of terminal diagnosis, by the way, just popping by is our next segment. If you didn't hear it, Trisha Paytas is having another baby, which means another royal family member has to die. Internet joke. Anyways, to be a little but not much more serious, Prince Harry is back in the US after spending barely 24 hours in the UK to see the now sick and dying King Charles. The king had told his sons and family about the cancer diagnosis before it was publicly announced. Harry left California for England within a day, but for someone who hadn't seen his father since his coronation in May of 2023, and said father is now dying, it shocked many that Harry just up and left so quickly after visiting. The visit was also done alone, no grandkids or wife tagging along. Harry also seemingly didn't want to see William still, who also has some medical issues. He just had surgery on his abdominal for some reason, but usually that's when your brother would come check on you. Instead, Harry actually ignores the next heir to the throne, does the menial visit with his dad, and takes back off within barely 24 hours to hot and sunny Cali to do. I'm not sure. I really don't know what his job is, and I don't even mean that in a mean way. I just really don't know. Speaking of taking off, there's some arguable soft exile evidence that'll definitely cause some self-glorification and righteous anger in the prince, seeing as Harry nearly faced a life of permanent exile with King Charles plotting to follow the playbook drawn up by the royals as they overcame the crisis triggered by Edward, the king who abdicated in 1936, to be with a twice divorcee, Wallace Simpson, and was thus obliged to live the rest of his life outside the UK. He was also hanging around with some dictators during World War II, so it's also partially that. Anyways, a best friend of the king's told Daily Beast, the royals handled the abdication crisis by exiling Edward, which meant he and Wallace ultimately came to seem like unimportant, misguided, disloyal, and even treacherous individuals to almost the entirety of the British people. It was a masterful operation in the service of which the Queen Mother in particular worked tirelessly. The same thing is already happening with Meghan and Harry, and will only gather pace over the next few years under the rule of King Charles. And of course, a wayward second son is far less of an existential threat to the fabric of the monarchy than a wayward king. Another source, a former Buckingham Palace staffer, told Daily Beast that King Charles's accession statement, in which he encouraged his sons and Meghan to, quote, continue continue to build their lives overseas was an undisguised message to the couple to not disrupt his reign by making frequent trips to the UK. That's enough to make anyone want to snatch a throne to prove a point, wouldn't you say? The news of this followed the revelation that Harry snubbed Charles, which is our next segment. It was reported by The Sun that Charles's offer to host dinner the night that he was at Balmoral following Queen Elizabeth's death after Charles had forbidden Meghan from joining Harry there, and he snubbed him. Instead of joining Charles, Camilla, and William at Charles's home on the Balmoral estate, Burkle, Harry went and stayed with Prince Andrew, Prince Edward, and his wife, so at Balmoral Castle itself. AKA, if the wife ain't coming, he ain't coming either. A source said Harry was so busy trying to get Meghan to Balmoral and rowing with his family that he missed the flight for dinner. Charles has an open invitation for Harry to dine with him whenever he's in the country. Harry was so furious that he refused to eat with his father and brother. It was a massive snub, and he got out of Balmoral at the earliest opportunity to catch the first commercial flight back to London. Meghan's treatment by the Windsor family for her race would be a big reason for Harry to dream upon getting the crown. What a way for him to rub it in the family's face. Even if Meghan can't be a formal queen without the royal blood, she'd still be on the throne next to him, and that'd be a bitter taste on a lot of old faces. Our last segment, however, is about how this couple's interest in a half-life may be a sign of a desire to still rank in the monarchy. Because although it was the couple themselves who decided to go live in America, they still seem to be eyeing a transcontinental rule for themselves. As they said in their first departure announcement, "We now plan to balance our time between the United Kingdom and North America." And they were equally open about their desire to continue to represent the monarchy while being able to, and I quote, "earn their own money." This plan was rebuffed by the Queen at the so-called Sangriam Summit, where the couple were told they could have no role in public life as part-time royals, in a palace statement that said that in stepping away from the work of a royal family, it is not possible to continue with the responsibilities and duties that come with a life of public service. They didn't say they're gonna do any duties. They just wanna show up and represent. Show face, literally just show face. AKA, that's code for, even if you offer to do this for free, we don't want you, any of your attempts at monarchy reform, and your biracial wife representing our pasty democracy. In response, Harry and Meghan basically said, oh yes, we can, just without, you know, putting the title on it, and issuing a statement that read, we can all live a life of service. Service is universal. Harry has made it explicitly clear in legal action he is bringing against the British government that he still expects some royal treatment, or at least protection while he's in the country for he and his wife, seeking automatic police protection when in the UK, and stating he still sees the UK as his home and wants to operate and represent there safely. In a submission made in January last year, Harry's legal team said the UK will always be Prince Harry's home and a country he wants his wife and children to be safe in. With the lack of police protection comes too great a personal risk, but they're also not gonna give it. They don't want you here to represent. At a February court hearing, Harry's barrister says it goes without saying that he does want to come back and see his family and friends and continue to support charities that are so close to his heart. The idea of Harry popping back over every few weeks to do public appearances that are automatically associated with the royal family, even if they don't want it to be, is likely to give Charles the chills. Nothing like building a rapport with the masses by outing the rest of the family as derogatory and unprogressive in a progressive age riddled with cancel culture. Call that some smart business planning for a man that maybe wants the throne. That is the end of another information overload video. I sure hope you enjoy. Take some time to share your opinions down in the comments, like, share, and of course, subscribe. I'll see you another time.